everybody, and thank you so much for being here for Deborah Kobylt Live. Thank you, Enzo De Palma, for that great music. In studio with me right now is someone I've been trying to get in here for quite some time, Pen Densham. Did I say that right?
Absolutely.
Spot on. Okay, great. Now, you're a tough one to introduce because you've done so much. You haven't just done one thing. So I'm going to take a crack at it. How's that?
That's wonderful.
Okay.
Thank you.
Pen, you are an artist. You are an author. You are a photographer. You are a filmmaker. You've done an awful lot. So we'll get as much into that as we can. But what I find interesting, because we've spoken on the phone many times, and I'm glad we finally were able to make this happen, you've written books to help other people who are artists hear their voice and get it out there if they're questioning themselves. That would include me and a lot of other people. You wrote the ebook, A Creative Person's Success Manual.
Right.
Right, and we'll talk about what that is. You also wrote this here, Riding the Alligator, and I know what this is named after because you...
I rode an alligator
when I was four years old. Now, I don't know what your parents were thinking, but that's okay. You live to tell about it, so...
Well, you know, I think the most profound thing is my mother died when I was quite young.
Like, 8 years
my
old.
My folks were making short films, going to the movie theaters. They don't think they could afford babysitters. And I went along and watched my father making, the camera was like this magic instrument. And from that age, I knew I wanted to cast spells with the camera. That then turned into my mother died, my father married a despicable woman. I was put in, as with my brothers, we were put in foster homes. There was an effort to try and drive creativity out of me to straighten me out. And it gave me an intense sense of wanting to support other people's creativity because I know how ephemeral it is. I know when you're trying to invent things that have never existed before, it doesn't take a lot of damage to pull them down. And they're balloons, and there's so many people trying to pull you down. I wanted to write and try and share some of the things I discovered to get through the pain of trying to get to my goals. And I, you know, there's a bad statement, which is if I could do it, anybody could do it.
However, you had a lot of pain, but you quit school when you were 15.
Yep.
And by the time you were 17, you were photographing the Rolling Stones. How did that happen?
I think there was a part of me that just yearned to break away from being tame, to be limited, that dream thing. What could I do? And I had this idea. I would talk to the BBC and suggest to them, why don't they let a teenager photograph the Rolling Stones candidly and see if the vision's any different? And they turned around and they said yes. And I found myself inside their dressing room being treated like a real person, which was amazed me.
Back up. What was Mick like? What were they all like? Oh, they must have thought you were the coolest kid. Right?
Oh, I don't think they really cared that much, but they were actually, the nicest person was, Mick was cool. The standoffish person was the bass player, Bill Wyman. I always thought I looked like drummer Bill Watts, but Keith Richards was the most friendly.
Hmm.
And it was, they were eating fish and chips in their dressing room in between the two shows. And they offered us them. But I was petrified. I was like shaking while I'm taking photos because I don't want
to
know. Who
wouldn't be?
You know, that I'm not real, you know.
But where did those photos end up?
I have them to this day. And they went into a television show. They've been published in magazines. And I still have it. I dug them out the other day and looked at them and said, oh, you weren't so terrible.
can Kurt find them on YouTube or something? Are they around?
No, they're not up. I never put them up. I don't put a lot of stuff up.
I should have had you send them to me.
I should have done, yes.
Send them. Honestly, if we have a second, you feel like fiddling with your phone, no problem doing that here.
Yeah.
So, wow, that's really exciting. But, okay, so you did that, and I know that you were deeply inspired by Marshall McLuhan, right?
Marshall McLuhan was the guru of communications around the world in the 60s.
Mm-hmm.
And I ended up working with a company that actually was trying to help Marshall McLuhan and Jane Jacobs, two of the luminaries of thinking at that time, stop the Spadina Expressway going through. So I'm 23 years old, and we're talking in a room, and he's talking about the sounds that you make when you create a name for a satellite and whether or not those sounds have emotions and purpose. And Jane Jacobs is talking about cities having life and being living entities. And Marshall McLuhan's talking about watching movies and how does the audience react. And if you look at the audience, you see they're in a trance with the movie. They're actually moving their faces with the actors on the screen. And I'm all this stuff is telling me that you can explore. You don't have to be in the little boxes like I was being taught as a kid, that you can actually go out and see where else these things go.
I'm absolutely convinced that if you're somebody who needs, who wants to be out of the box, you're just going to fight your way out, hopefully. Because so many artists are told when they're kids, that, hey, you're a little crazy, you don't need it, go be a bookkeeper.
Yes, right.
You know, and
be a bookkeeper. Right.
Be a bookkeeper. Yes. That was mine, be a bookkeeper. But you just keep going.
Learn to repair radios.
Learn
that
to
was my father.
Oh, you
sent
repaired
me to
radios?
Night school. No, I was no good. I couldn't figure out what the Ohm's law, the resistance codes, none of that stuff, because they were mathematical. That, trying to help us. But I'll tell you one thing, the most powerful thing was the people that encouraged me. When I was vulnerable, one person, we pitched the idea of Robin Hood to three different studios, all told me it was the stupidest
idea. That's okay. People can follow us. Robin Hood, Den of Thieves.
Prince of Thieves.
Sorry. Prince of Thieves.
And three studios told me, stupid idea, men with swords, no one wants to see them, men with guns they want to see. And our assistant said, if you start writing it, I'll help you. So I wrote it on spec because one person... She blew on the glow of hope and made it happen.
Why did you write that? I read the reason behind it, but I want you to tell me why you wrote Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves.
I had the privilege of having a child with my wife, and I looked at the world differently, and I said, how do we speak to the world as mythology makers, to the world that my kid grows up in? And I wanted to write a story where men killing people was not considered success and heroic. And at that time, that was the Schwarzenegger, Stallone movies. Human beings were target practice. And I wanted to write a story based on my culture, which was that actually doing altruistic things and putting your life at risk for the future of other people was the definition of heroism. And
wow.
I was really moved to try and put a Muslim and a Christian side by side, helping each other at a time when that was not fashionable, because religions are really just trying to get to moral values, and why should they fight each other? They should help each other. So,
well, then you need to do one about that now. Is this ever going to stop? I mean,
human beings are basically moral. They're just people that get in charge and they mislead them to their own benefits, and we just need good information systems. And I have great faith that the internet, as much as people think it manipulates, it also allows information. It's pretty hard to hide anything now.
Can I comment on that? I think the internet can be phenomenal. I have friends who just won't go on Instagram, for example. I love Instagram. I pick and choose what I want on there. I do not have anyone on there taking ridiculous selfies that I'm not interested
right,
in.
Yes.
You know, I love little animal stories. They calm me down. They make me very happy. So I have probably every possible animal, whatever, on my Instagram. Even this morning, I actually woke up very early, and I was looking at little chimpanzees. And you can choose what you want to look at
having
social.
Having worked with McLuhan, who thought that the global village was television.
Mm-hmm.
The internet is the most phenomenal thing that human beings have ever experienced. The Gutenberg was the galaxy. He called the Gutenberg the galaxy because it changed humans being able to, everybody could access reading. Now what we have is for free, instantly, around the world, communication with vast troves of information. It's the Encyclopedia Britannica on acid. I mean, everything that you could possibly imagine is in our iPhone, and no one ever knew that this could happen. No one experienced that possibility in all the science fiction I read as a kid. No one said that absolutely universal engagement for free around the world.
It's taken some time, though, for people to figure it out because so much was thrown at us all at once.
Yeah,
and
we have an ocean thrown at us.
Yeah,
and
entire
an ecosystem.
Ocean.
Yeah.
Yeah, an ecosystem, the universe, everything. And now I think people are realizing there are choices there. And it's to nobody's, no one was at fault there. It's just,
but
it was
also
too
means
much
no boundaries. So in other words, if you put together a cellular political stance, someone in another country is putting a different one, and a teenager can see both. And they can make comparisons, and then they can email and viral their friends. And so ideas are moving at the speed of light.
It's very fascinating. It's beautiful. You know what I love? That you can do a film. I think we talked about this. You can just do it on your phone. You don't have to make it complicated. You don't need all this. You can do an interview on your phone. It doesn't even have to be visual. It can be audio.
Absolutely, because when I was making movies, when we first started out, every time we switched on the camera, we burned money. Mm-hmm. And every time we did something, we had to hire an editing machine. And every time we finished it, we had to hire a sync sound system to go put it all together.
And you need five everything people to work that phone. Stuff. Yeah, you're right. I'm a big phone person. In fact, I do a lot of my work on my phone. I write on my phone. I put content, all kinds of content out on my phone. And sometimes people will say, why are you always on it? I'm like, no. I'm working. It's like you working at the office at, the electric company. You know,
well,
what
you're
I'm
discovering
doing.
The new way of using that ecosystem.
Yeah, I like the phone. So, okay, so Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves. You've also done a tremendous amount of television, revivals of The Outer Limits, The Twilight Zone. I don't know, you've done almost too much to mention. It's so incredible.
And the thing about a creative person,
yeah.
I don't validate that. I did it all, but the thing I'm most upset about is that I haven't accomplished the things I want to do.
Whoa, what are those?
I have a film that I yearn to make, which it represents an understanding of the Native American culture because it puts a white man with a tragedy in his past to investigate the murder of a Navajo artist. And what it does is it enables me to look at the world of the Navajo, their cultures, their beliefs, their honor systems, their sense that the world is a beautiful place to be celebrated every day, that they're responsible for the next seven generations for the land they live on. So,
year does it take?
It takes place. It's current. It's a white detective and a female tribal police officer, each who have issues with their own personalities, learning from each other as they explore a murder, which causes them to be able to reconceive themselves as whole people.
I think that's beautiful. Look, we're here on super borrowed time. It's true.
Yes.
And as every year that goes by, we know that. So if that's really in your bucket list, out of your bucket list.
And I have one more bucket list, which is I have a film that is about a child growing up on a desert island stranded with just dolphins as its companions. I call it a wet Tarzan, but really it's another opportunity to look at how does the environment affect us. And it's a love story between a girl who's 17 who arrives at the island with her oceanographer father. He's kidnapped by illegal fishermen and dumped there at that age. And I look at all of these wonderful, fantastic, costume-suited action movies, and there's no nutrition. They're fat for the head. There's nothing in there. And I'm saying, why can't we make entertainment that actually has a seed of some value in them, where they speak to something that our Earth needs without it being a lecture, without it being dominant, but it's just something that becomes obvious. If you create beauty, you hope that people want to preserve it.
It's a story, and any good story can be told, no matter even the genre. But I love this idea that she befriends the dolphin, the dolphin helps her.
It's a young man who's stranded with dolphins and grows up with dolphins. So he's at the age of four, he's left alone and forages for himself and is befriended by a pod and pair bonded with a young male dolphin. And it's not like he speaks dolphinese, or it's just what would happen if you took an anthropological position and you grew up around nature? And
I think about those things all the time.
And it's like a Tarzan. You learn to value what's there because we don't experience it. So I wanted to create an environmental hero who could speak through the beauty of that environment.
Well, it's interesting. We are human beings and relate to other human beings. But when you think about all the creatures in the world, particularly those under the sea, I mean, we know about dolphins and whales, but there's so many deep under the sea. And they each speak to one another. And there's a whole world going on under there. And the world that's going on here, we don't quite speak to one another. Like animals, we're killing the animals
yes.
and we're poaching animals. There's not a respect. And I wonder when we will ever get to the point where we have a mutual respect, where we're not killing for tusks or for, do you know what I mean?
Well, there is a survival instinct in human beings. One hopes that that takes over when you start to see you threaten your own future. And maybe selfishness will cause people to want to not do these things.
Well, you say survival, but that's for greed,
Yeah, well, I, you know, like you and I, we both probably have a great feeling that a lot of people own the very top people at the systems are looking to exploit. I think the oil is being brought out before it runs out and is no use because solar takes over. And so everybody's repressing solar who want to make money. And,
it's true.
There's enough of us, which are intelligent and caring people, to push that back. But it takes democracy, as Churchill said, it's the worst of all the systems except all the others, to help it. And we have to stand up.
It's exhausting. Yes. It can be very exhausting.
But look at the young kids that have taken on the gun lobby and actually changing things. It took pain, but I was so proud of them. It gave me great hope. And I came through the anti-Vietnam era. We had draft dodgers and a couple of deserters in our basement in Toronto. Gave them a place while they stabilized. And it was a war that no one understood. And I'm not opposed to fighting morality wars, which have to be stood up to. Somebody has to make sacrifices sometimes. But when you're being exploited or used, then some people have to fight back.
Absolutely. So you were born in...
England.
Fled to Canada when you were just 19 years old. Yep. And it was Norm Jewison, right? Yes. He's pretty much the one responsible bringing you over here to Hollywood.
I had a lovely experience in Canada because people treated me as a filmmaker and not whether I'd had an education.
I bet you had such an old soul as a kid. And they saw that and they thought, wow, this guy's something special. So, I mean, come on. If you're capturing the attention of somebody like a Norm Jewison.
Well, Norm Jewison looked at one of the... I didn't make a drama. I was too scared to write. We did documentaries, my partner and I. And then finally, after doing documentaries for a long period of time, I wrote one drama. I thought it was awful. We edited it together. I thought I'd save my ass by editing it together. And it won 14 awards, and it was reviewed as the best film of any length ever shown on TV in
Canada. Which film was this?
It was called If Wishes Were Horses. It was a drama about a horse breech birthing and the two people struggling to turn the foal or choose whether the mother or the child had to die. Ooh. And I swore I would never direct again. I thought, and then Norman comes along and says, "You're really good." And you go, "Oh, no, somebody else. Take somebody else." So, you know, and I'm sharing that because I want people to see what an imbecile creativity is. It doesn't have logic. Now I look back and say, "Oh, yeah, I actually probably had talent."
You know, and he saw it.
I had ambition. I didn't know I had talent. That was the difference.
Well, you
and
had
I
both.
Actually saw Norman last week.
You did?
He was, the AFI was having a special screening of Moonstruck. And
I read about that.
And to see the movie again... Oh. It's so intelligent, so beautifully made. No, unfortunately. But to see her performance and why she won an Oscar, so
bad
internal.
Of it. Yeah. I loved her. Yes. She was so organic is what it was.
Yes.
She was Cher in Moonstruck.
Yes.
You know, I really did love her. You're right. This is why she won the Oscar. You've won over 70 international awards. Is
yes.
that correct?
Right.
And you got a medal, if not more than one medal, from the Queen.
Yes, we got a medal from the Queen for our contribution to the arts and sciences of Canada.
Wow. When was that?
Oh, it was in the late 70s. It was her jubilee year. And we were invited to meet her, but they sent the medals ahead of time. And so mine arrived with a little bow tie and a little gong, silver medal, her picture on it, beautiful thing, and the invite. And my partners didn't arrive for several days, and he wasn't sure he was going to get one.
Oh, they were freaked out probably. Oh, my God.
And then his medal arrived, but there was a gong, there was a ribbon, and there was a pin. And he gave it secretly to the secretary of mine and said, "Make mine look like pens." And then when he brought it back, I realized we now both had medals from the Queen that looked like women's medals.
Oh, no.
Because they thought his pen was Penelope.
No way.
Yes.
Oh, that's hilarious. So you got to meet her, though.
We got to meet her, got to meet Prince Philip. Sir Philip Moore, the Queen's royal secretary, sat next to me and asked me to send films to the Royal Library. And we actually...
Oh, come on. If you didn't know that you made it then. I mean, that's quite an experience.
We got holes in our shoes.
I know. Did you at least get a new pair of shoes when you met the Queen?
We dressed as best we could. We would go to the... secondhand stores and buy suits to go pitch movies because we couldn't afford clothes.
This is the way of the artist. People think it's just all, you know, glamour.
And if
not really.
And if you bent too quickly, the threads would tear.
Your arm would come out. Yeah, the jacket. Yeah. I mean, that's hysterical. It's so true. So what do you work on now? Let's talk a little bit about your books, first of all, because I know you're very, very passionate about giving something back to the artist, because we all question ourselves constantly. You probably still question yourself daily.
Absolutely.
I do, to the point where I'm having a hard time getting something out. You know, okay, just while we were sitting here, right, I got a call from one of the comedy clubs here in town, and I was saying to you, I do comedy, but I don't really think I'm so good. And they, almost like on cue, they called me, and I'm thinking, they're calling me? But that's the way it works. You know, we just have to keep going even though we don't believe we're good at something. Does that make sense?
Well, the most vulnerable thing is to have this incredible imagination, because it actually confuses you. You can think of things that never existed, and you can think of all the reasons why you shouldn't do it. And people who are low monitors, people who are, you know, the people that build our bridges and the people that put together budgets and the things that are all very sane, we actually have to get them on board our dreams.
Well, and I will tell you, I live with people like that.
Yeah.
My husband is a voracious reader, but I think sometimes he looks at me like, what's she talking about? Because it's very difficult when you think in a certain way.
Yes.
For sort of the regular folk, not that they're regular people, but, you know, who they're more linear to understand when you're the way your mind works, if it's a little more esoteric.
And there are people like Sir Ken Robinson, who have the best TED talk, the number one TED talk.
Which who says, is that?
Sir Ken Robinson has the number one TED talk, which is How Schools Kill Creativity.
Well, don't talk to me. I call it the one room schoolhouse.
And here's the logic. The problem is we don't actually associate with people like ourselves. We're not actually pooled together. And so what happens is we don't get a sense of collegiality. We don't get the methods, the ecosystem to how to survive. When we create something, you absolutely need reinforcement. You need people who I call story midwives for writing, people that are helping you give birth through the pain and not telling you what sex the child has to be. And
that's a good one. I need a midwife.
And you have to spend as much time selling what you do to the pragmatics, because you can't get to your dreams unless you can get them on board.
Okay, hold on. Yeah. That's the hard part. Because often an artist will have a tough time then going out and going, I have an idea here, because I know I'm not good at that at all. I'll write all day and then I'll think, who do I send it to? Right. It's a big roadblock.
Quick system.
Quick.
First thing is you hand your material early to people that are very safe. You don't give it to people who are going to be dogmatic or are going to be egotistical or jealous. Hmm. You give it to people who will tell you how good it is and what things you need to fix. You must asshole-proof your work before you give it to people who are not necessarily going to understand it.
Can I steal that? You must asshole-proof your work. Love that.
And then what happens is you get confidence in it because you've given it to people that are telling you the truth. And then when you go out with it, you have a certain sense of what it is. The next thing is you must describe it in terms of successes that your buyer wants to achieve.
This is great. And by the way, people can learn about this, right, in Riding the Alligator.
Yeah, Riding the Alligator was my attempt to write a book that I would have yearned to read. It's not telling you how to do it. It's encouraging you how to bring it out of yourself. The word educe, which education comes from, is the Greek word to bring forth. Mm-hmm. My attitude is if people are trying to help me bring forth, I'd had a lot more sense of confidence. Mm-hmm. And that's what I yearn to give with that book, is you're not abnormal. This is the process. It is idiotic. It is idiosyncratic. It doesn't always make sense. Nothing is wasted if you write or create towards your voice. It's wasted when you try and copy what other people did with no heart in it from yourself. You're not exercising the muscles.
Well, then you
muscles.
May not be a real artist if that's the case.
Well, but we might be talked into that.
Yeah, if you're really compelled to go copy somebody's work,
well, the studios would love you to do that.
Who?
The studios would love you to do that because they want another one like that because they think it works.
But things are changing, you know that. People can put out their own stuff on YouTube.
Right.
You can go to
which is coming out of your iPhone. Well, yeah. Somebody's going to make a movie that's going to gross $100 million out of an iPhone. And then all bets are off. Why do you need a studio at that point?
You know, and then you can sell stuff now on your own to the Netflixes of the world. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that's hard too now. It's getting, you know, flooded, that area too.
More places to go and sell work than I've ever seen in my life.
Which is very exciting and inspiring. You don't have to sit home and wait for the phone to ring for that part or that your script is picked up.
Make a trailer.
Yeah.
Do something and then check it out with people you trust to make sure that it's worth sending out, and fix it until it's ready to go out. You know, creativity doesn't happen on its own. It happens in layers. You know, I always like to say, well, if you looked at Leonardo's paintings and you x-rayed them, you'll see all these crossings out. And sometimes he took years to get through a painting. So he's a fucking idiot, right? Because he had to know. In fact, that is what the process is you put something down, you sculpt it a bit more, you step back, you look at it, and you need other people to say, well, that person's head's too big, so, and then it fits.
What does it say about me that as a little girl, and I mean little, I was obsessed with him. In fact, I was so obsessed with him because it never went away. I would sketch his face.
Yeah.
I was obsessed with this man, the fact that he was a scientist
yes.
and that he was an artist and all of it, to the point where on my honeymoon, I insisted on going to the town of Vinci.
Oh,
I just had to see, talk about an obsession. And there's this little museum of replicas of his artwork, of his work, whether it was a plane or, you know, the body. I went there too because I just had to see it.
Great thinker.
And somebody feel where I just needed to go through the alleys of where he walked. I must be related to this man.
So, I mean, is it because you saw in him somebody that wasn't trapped in the box? Is it because...
Yeah, I thought he was really cool. Yeah. I just thought he was cool. I thought he looked cool. I thought what did he write? All of his theories upside down and backwards.
Yeah.
And the only way to really, you know, to see it was to, you know, put it in front of a mirror.
Yeah.
I don't know what it was. I was a little kid, and I became seriously obsessed. So what does that say about me?
I think it means that inside you is this creative person that's yearning to explore and to do things of value. Most people are definitively moral, and they try and find something to do with their lives that they see that makes a difference. And making a difference is whatever it feels to you.
Yeah, it's great. Very exciting. I encourage everybody to do that, really, in any way. Also, I love your ebook, A Creative Person Success Manual. And the reason behind all of this is because you yourself have been creative. Oh, my gosh, we didn't even get to it. As an artist, photographer, very briefly, we don't have that much time. Could you tell us a little bit about that as well?
I loved cameras when I was growing up. I have a collection of over 100 cameras. But I gave up on my photography because I could never take pictures that made me impassioned. And then I looked at my daughter using my cameras, who hadn't been taught, who hadn't been told what you had to do, and her pictures were ethereal and magical. Mm. And I stopped trying to make the way that other people said. I said, what do I feel? And I started shaking the camera when I was taking a picture. Or I would move my hands as the picture was being taken. Or I would take a time exposure of something you're not supposed to take time exposures of, koi, water, waves. And I recently photographed in India on the streets and taking camera movements so that people's faces were blurred. And
you work in colors.
And in color. And what's happening is it's no longer photography. It's a vision, an emotion. And there's a term, qualia, which I've really just discovered, which I think is beautiful, which is a philosophical term for a thing that cannot be described in words. It's only emotion. And
beautiful.
So
I
use a camera like a paintbrush, not a gun.
Well, we can see some of your work on YouTube because I was looking it up, in fact, this morning, and I watched it time and time again. Someone did a piece on you. It's only 3 minutes, and you could just see the work that you compose. Oh, lovely. Also, isn't it shown here at a gallery or will be in the future?
I have a friend called Thomas Schuss who has a place called Schuss Design. And
fabulous,
it's like a secret
gallery.
So it's only on application can you get in there. Because I'm not into selling so much as I am into exploring.
Creating, yeah.
But there's a website for him, and if you go there, you can see the photos.
You're going to take me, remember?
I'm going to take you because
I went away, then you went away.
When
yeah.
we go there.
We're going to go.
Exciting.
Because we've met, we've connected, now we've got to go. So I don't know. There's so much else to say, but we're sort of out of time. Is there anything you want to add?
Well, if people want to get to my website,
pendensham.com. Wait, what is it?
It's pdensham.com.
It's P Densham.
Yeah.
P-D-E-N-S-H-A-M.
And then you can go to the book and download the free book, or you can go look at my photos, or you can look at the bio of our company. And really what I also say this to people, I'm on Facebook. If you ask a question, I'm not reading people's scripts. That's just not happening. But if you ask a question, I try and respond. I figure my goal is to say to people, if you have the ambition, I'll try and support it.
I love that. So look you up also on Facebook. If you want to instant message him, he'll eventually get back to you. And I know you will.
Yes.
Can they email you too? Or?
Yeah, no, preferably not.
Okay.
I mean, and that's the other thing about selling. I get emails every day, which is I have a horror film. I never get an email which says, I've seen Moll Flanders, your historical movie. I've seen Houdini, your historical movie. I've seen Robin Hood. I have another historical movie I think you might be excited by. Because no one actually studies the person they want to sell to. And that's the trouble with email, is it's imprecise and it is ephemeral. Whereas if you actually want to get the attention of somebody, write them a letter.
Okay.
Because a letter goes on their desk. The secretaries are stunned when a letter comes.
Or instant message you.
Yeah.
Now, we have a trailer, right, from Penn?
We do, yes.
Can we end our show with that and take it all the way through? How long is that?
A minute and a half time.
Yeah, that's what we'll do. So we're going to sign off now. I appreciate you being with us.
Thank you for
so
having
much,
me.
Penn Densham. You can find him on Facebook. Go to his website, pdensham.com. There you can find out how to get a copy of Riding the Alligator and also download a Creative Person Success Manual and just see all your work, your photography, the films, just so much more. You're such a creative intellect. I mean, it's just incredible.
No, don't forget, I'm scared and I haven't validated. I am desperately trying to figure out how to break through and sell the things I care about. So it's like the past doesn't count. I'm only about the future.
It all counts. It's all part of who you are, you know, but I get it. Anyway, thank you for being here. We will finish with his trailer. And please look us up on YouTube, Facebook, Apple Podcasts, iHeartRadio, and anywhere else that you get your podcasts. Thanks. See you soon. And please just watch the trailer. Bye-bye.